Will you join me in our opening prayer today? O living God of past and future, we praise you for this present moment. Fill us with your joy and empower us with your Holy Spirit that our strength may be renewed to sing a new song of your glory in a world which longs for your justice and peace. All this we ask in the name of Jesus, in whom we become your new creation. Amen.
Let's walk together for a while and ask where we begin to build a world where love can grow and hope can enter in, to be the hands of healing and to plant the seed of
morning. Welcome to Leawood United Methodist Church. This is the beginning of a series. The other day a congregant asked me, "Can we go back to church now?" I hesitated and said, "Well, probably not yet." And there it is. That's basically the summary of our strange new moment in time, isn't it? The uncertainty in that response drives home our lack of control. Is it safe to go to the grocery store? Will I lose my job? What will the next weeks or months bring? Sometimes I feel like a kid in the back seat of God's car asking, "Are we there yet? Huh? These days present an opportunity for us as people of faith to pause long enough to dig into some of the deeper questions such times as this raise. Will God truly be victorious in the end? When will that be? Has it begun already? Can we go back? Will I be left behind? Where is hope? How can all of this be happening in the world God created? How long, O Lord? Or as my little voice speaks from the back seat, how much longer, Mommy and Daddy? Join us as we ponder the importance of these questions in our lives today. Together we'll explore how to embrace the coming triumph of God and how it empowers our compassion for our world, even in uncertain times like these. When we hear these joyful words in Psalm 98, we sometimes forget how their power is most great for persons who may be facing great difficulty and trial, like ourselves.
Psalm 98. Sing to the Lord a new song because he has done wonderful things. His own strong hand and his own holy arm have won the victory. The Lord has made his salvation widely known. He has revealed his righteousness in the eyes of all the nations. God has remembered his loyal love and faithfulness to the house of Israel. Every corner of the earth has seen God's salvation. Shout triumphantly to the Lord, all the earth. Be happy. Rejoice out loud. Sing your praises. Sing your praises to the Lord with the lyre and the sound of music. With trumpets and a horn blast, shout triumphantly before the Lord, the King. Let the sea and everything in it roar. The world and all its inhabitants too. Let all the rivers clap their hands. Let the mountains rejoice out loud all together before the Lord, because he is coming to establish justice on the earth. He will establish justice in the world rightly. He will establish justice among all the people fairly.
So, okay. Well, let me know when it's ready.
We're good.
It's live? We're
live.
Good?
Live.
Okay. Thank you. All right. Sorry about that. I've been waiting for like, I don't know, 14 seconds. And sometimes I have a hard time waiting. So how about you? Do you have any issues waiting? How about when it's your birthday? You know, you can see it on the calendar. Mom marked it. All right. You know it's coming. You know you're going to see some family, some friends. Most likely going to get some presents. Is it hard to wait for your birthday? Yeah, a little bit. And don't even get me started on Christmas. Why does that always take so long to get here? I don't know. How about, have you ever been in the car, maybe on a family vacation or going to relatives who live quite a ways away? I don't know. Did you ever lean up and say, how much further? Are we there yet? Well, you kids actually shouldn't, because you have electronics. You can each be watching your own device, listening to your own music, doing whatever you want to. Oh, well, let me tell you, when I was a kid, we had I Spy and the Alphabet Game, and we were glad to have it. But I digress. Okay, any time that we have to wait on something, and we don't know how long it's going to take, it makes us feel uncertain and anxious because we don't have any control over it. We just have to wait. And it's always been like that. I think about Noah. When God was telling Noah how big to build the ark, you know, I bet at some point he thought, I wonder how long this is going to take. And then when they get in the ark, Noah, his wife, their three boys and their wives, I'm sure at least one of them came up to Noah. I don't know, I'm just guessing here. I'm thinking Shem. Probably came up to Noah and said, Dad, how much longer? This is really stinky. You know, then there's Joseph. When his brothers sold him to the traders who were coming through, do you think Joseph maybe was sitting there thinking, ooh, how much further do I have to go? Bet that thought entered his mind. And Jesus, after he was crucified and he rose from the dead, he saw his disciples, they got to spend some time with him, but then he told them, I'm going to leave, but I'm coming back. Well, they thought that meant, I don't know, a few weeks, a few months, maybe a few years. And guess what? We're still waiting 2,000 years later. Well, right now, all of us have had to change the way we live because of this virus that's going around. And we just kind of wonder, well, how much longer is this going to take? And that's pretty common because we're looking at it through our eyes and not God's. Now, we can't possibly understand what God's plan is through all this. We can't imagine what has to happen for it to end. But I do think that God actually has a plan. And I think it's good to have faith that he does have a plan. And what we need to do is realize that God doesn't work on our time. We work in God's time. He sees the whole picture. And instead of us asking, how much longer until I can go to the swimming pool? Or when can I go to a baseball game? Think about this. Ask God, how can I best serve you at this time? Because as much as we would want mom and dad to snap their fingers and get us to our vacation site, and as much as we want God to just snap his fingers and end this, that's not going to happen. We're being a part of God's time. And all we can do is be the best that we can to be ready when he calls on us. Let's say a quick prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for all that you have given us. And even though we don't understand some things that happen, help us to remain positive, to always love you, and to do as you wish. In your precious name, all the children said, Amen. Are you going to turn it off? It's been over for like 5 seconds.
What we hear in this passage from the Apostle Paul moves away from his previous messages to the community in Corinth about how they were treating one another and behaving in the world. Those early messages focused on the now. And in this passage, he refocuses their thoughts on the not yet. Those things that have begun but are not yet accomplished in and through Christ and may yet guide them as they too move to greater things.
I'm reading today from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 20 through 28. but in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead. He's the first crop of the harvest of those who have died. Since death came through a human being, the resurrection of the dead came through one too. In the same way that everyone dies in Adam, so also everyone will be given life in Christ. Each event will happen in the right order. Christ, the first crop of the harvest, then those who belong to Christ at his coming, and then the end, when Christ hands over the kingdom to God the Father, when he brings every form of rule, every authority and power to an end. It is necessary for him to rule until he puts all enemies under his feet. Death is the last enemy to be brought to an end, since he has brought everything under control under his feet. When it says that everything has been brought under control, this clearly means everything except for the one who placed everything under his control. But when all things have been brought under his control, then the Son himself will also be under the control of the one who gave him control over everything, so that God may be all in all.
Thank you.
In Revelation 1:8, we hear, I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. It is not by accident that those words are in Revelation, the last book in our Bible. It represents a culmination of thinking about who God was, is, and always shall be. But throughout the scriptures, humans have grappled with those very questions. In many early writings, God, all-powerful creator, is considered so distant that to speak that name would be unimaginable. The power of such a creator intimidated humanity at times. Even today, some view God as the storm cloud on top of Mount Sinai, awaiting Moses, the only one who would dare to ascend. Our greatest vulnerability as people may come in how our hopes and understandings of the end times are framed. The coming apocalypse of God, the ultimate revelation, if you will. In Paul's letters, he addresses the deep yearning of the people for Jesus to return again. They expect the public manifestation of God's reign, defeating all enemies, vindicating Israel to all nations. But in Ezekiel 36, God states this very clearly. Therefore say to the house of Israel, thus says the Lord God, it is not for your sake, O house of Israel, that I am about to act, but for the sake of my holy name. For Christians, embracing the death and resurrection of Christ inaugurates that righteousness of God. And the question still echoes, will God prevail and uphold the claims made? The Corinthians and the Thessalonians and many other early Christians were beginning to wonder that very question. Paul, in his writings, reminds them that the coming of Christ was only the first fruits of what was to come. In the passage in Corinthians 15 read earlier, Paul is quite clear to whom Christ answers. Christ answers to God. Let's remember for a moment the context of some of these early Christian church groups. Paul's task was to remind and convince his early mission communities to hold fast to and embrace that God Almighty is indeed the first and the last. His words remind us today of the same truth. The truth that our temporal nature of our existence and that the difficulties we now face are not the end of the story. The Thessalonians themselves were a mixed up group of former pagans and other early Christians who were having the experience of feeling like they were attacked on all sides. Time was important to them. The Corinthians lived in what was at that time a complex and sophisticated urban setting. They even found themselves often falling into moments of confusion, pettiness, and ambition, and enthusiasm and fervor. They were trying to figure out how to be the church in a world that seemed out of their control. How do we live in freedom and holiness in the middle of this mess? They could not solidify their identity in the pluralistic context in which they lived. What's important? What matters? In response to these early Christian communities, Paul takes them back to basics. I guess you might think of it this way. Even though most sports have come, as we know them, have come to a standstill, we can still imagine that moment, can't we? When the home team comes up to bat in the bottom half of the ninth inning, the score is tied, or maybe the team is trailing in the game. And as they come up, we feel that surge of energy, that burst of hope that comes from knowing we bat last. Jesus, Paul, and many of the disciples remind people as they meet them that no matter the trials they endure, God bats last. As a seminary professor added to that statement, God's not going to miss. The faith which began in early Judaism that God will vindicate God's self flows even through to our time. for Christians through the demonstration of God's love in Jesus Christ. Death will be defeated. Everything will be under God's control. Psalm 98 calls for a song-filled celebration of God, of what God will do, and even suggests the promise will go to all the world, even establishing justice among all the people fairly. Shout triumphantly to the Lord, all the earth. Be happy. Rejoice out loud. Sing your praises. Sing your praises to the Lord with the lyre and the sound of music, with trumpets and a horn blast. Shout triumphantly before the Lord, the King. Let the sea and everything in it roar, the world and all its inhabitants too. Let all the rivers clap their hands. Let the mountains rejoice out loud all together before the Lord, because he is coming to establish justice on the earth. He will establish justice in the world rightly. He will establish justice among all people fairly. It's a fundamental part of who we are. It's in our very identity to embrace and faithfully look to God's batting last, God's final word, redeeming creation, bringing justice to all, calming us down, giving us a base upon which to stand when the ground is shaking, as it is now for many of us. In one of my many pastor Zoom group conversations I've had recently, I've begun to sense what to many will be a fearful reality, that how we do church may never be the same again. Some, if not many things, many practices will change. Our identity, however, is not rooted in how we did things or the specific ways in which we have been the church, but in who God is. The Almighty, the Alpha and Omega, who was, is, and ever shall be. It is shaped by the love of God through the teachings and actions of Jesus Christ. Friends, I don't know what inning we're in right now, or if even using the analogy of a game for our lives is even relevant or even matters. But I do know, and I believe in the end, God will step up. As it says in Revelation 21, God's dwelling is here with humankind. God will dwell with us and we will be God's people. God will be with us as our God will wipe away every tear from our eyes. Death will be no more. There will be no mourning, crying, or pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. Thanks be to God. Amen. These words from the Revelation to John offer us comfort, hope, and courage to cope with the realities of life, enlarging our story, seeing our lives as part of God's large story of redemption.
John writes in Revelation 21, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'See, the home of God is now among the people. He will dwell with them. They will be his peoples. And God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the old order of things have passed away.' And the one who was seated on the throne said, 'See, I am making all things new.' Also he said, 'Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true.' Then he said to me, 'It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life.'" hope in the promise that God will dwell with us and wipe away every tear. We mention in our hearts those we know who are lonely or isolated, those who are crying, the sad, the depressed and anxious, who are in mourning, who are sad and who know tears. We hope in the promise that death and mourning will be no more. Lord, you said, "See, I am making all things new." And all the people say, "Amen, make all things new." We pray for those who are in pain, suffering from illness, either physical or mental. We hope in the promise that crying and pain will be no more. We mention in our hearts those we know who are ill or who are in pain. Lord, you said, "See, I am making all things new." And all the people say, "Amen, make all things new." We pray for those who are thirsty for truth, love, and grace, who seek God and His life with earnest hearts. We hope in the promise that God will give water to the thirsty without cost from the spring of the water of life. We mention in our hearts those we know who hunger and thirst for God. Lord, you said, "See, I am making all things new." And all the people say, "Amen, make all things new." Lord, your words are trustworthy and true. You are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. We pray all this in the powerful and hopeful name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Hear these words of benediction, inspired by Revelation 21. God invites us into God's future, where the one who makes all things new has made his home among us. We are called and chosen, together embraced by the God in whom tears, mourning, crying, pain, and even death will be no more. Remember God's future, for this is our story. Our Lord says, "See, I am coming soon." And we respond, "Come, Lord Jesus." Amen.